Hello and welcome to The Pier. Welcome to our online service for the week of July 2nd. If you're brand new, we want to say welcome to you. We're so glad you've joined us. And we'd love for you to connect with us, to take a next step into our community. You can email us at info@thepier.church to just introduce yourself, or you could fill out a connect card, just kind of giving us some info so we can connect back with you by clicking on the link that's in the description for this video, or you can go to our website. You'll find a link there as well. Now, if you are part of our online community, but you'd like to know more about what's happening so that you can connect on a deeper level with us, we'd love to help you there too. We post what's going on Facebook and Instagram, but we also have a weekly newsletter, an email newsletter that goes out, and you can subscribe to that. So if that's of interest to you, give us an email at info@thepier.church so we can connect you with that. Now, in terms of what's coming up, just want to make you aware of a couple things. Through the summer, we're going to be continuing our Sunday suppers. This is a chance for us to serve people in our community by providing meals. And we need a good team in place to have that happen each month. The one for July is happening July 17th. And if you'd like to be involved in that, we'd love to hear from you. Again, email us at info@thepier.church to sign up. The summer's a good chance to try it out because some of our regular volunteers take some time off to go on vacation and that sort of thing. Also, we want you to know our youth group is still in full swing over the summer. We're going to be doing some fun events and that sort of thing. And so this coming week, July 8th, we've got a pool party that's happening. If you'd like to hear more, email us info@thepier.church. One last thing, and this is about our online services. Starting next week, you're still going to be able to get the service, but it's going to be available later on Sunday afternoon instead of right at 10 a.m. This is just a little shift we're doing over the summer to help us with our summer schedule, but it'll be back to normal in September. So starting next week, our online service will still be available, but later in the afternoon on Sunday. You can access it then or anytime after that. Great, that's a bit about what's going on. Now we're moving into our service. And what we would love for you to do to start out is to let go of your week that you've come from and don't worry about the future. Let's just take some time to focus on the present and to center our hearts and our minds on Jesus. Today is a special service. It's our family service. So we'd also love for you to invite your kids in. We've got some songs for them. We've got a Jesus story. So turn up the volume and get ready for that. We also have our communion today. We're celebrating communion. So one more step of preparation. Go grab a great beverage of your choice and grab some bread so that you can be ready for our communion time. We're going to jump in now, but before we do that, I just want to pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for this time. We ask that you'd bless it. Help us, Lord, to concentrate and to focus on you, Lord Jesus. Help us to let go of the busyness, the worry, the stress of the week we've just been through. Help us to give our future over to you in safe hands. And help us just to be in this moment together with you, Lord Jesus. Holy Spirit, we invite you to move. We invite you to guide and direct. Do with this time whatever you want to do. So it's in your name, Lord Jesus, we pray. Amen. All right, I invite you to stand up now, turn up the volume, get ready to clap along, dance along, as we sing some songs together. This first one is called One Way. Let's sing together. I lay my life down at your feet. You're the only one I need. Turn to you and you are always there. In troubled times it's you I seek. I put you first, that's all I need. I humble all I am, all to you. One way, Jesus, you're the only one that I could live for. One way, Jesus, you're the only one that I could live for.
second verse. You are always, always there, every how and everywhere. Your grace abounds so deeply within me. You will never, ever change. Yesterday, today, the same. Forever meets forever till no end. One way, Jesus, you're the only one that I could live for. One way, Jesus, you're the only one that I could live for. One way, Jesus, you're the only one that I could live for. One way, Jesus, you're the only one that I could live for.
You're the way, the truth, and the life. Here we go.
You are the way, the truth, and the life. Live by faith and not by sight. For you, we're living all for you. You are the way, the truth, and the life. We live by faith and not by sight. For you, living all for you.
One way,
one way, Jesus, you're the only one that I could live for. One way, Jesus, you're the only one that I could live for. One way, Jesus, you're the only one that I could live for. One way, Jesus, you're the only one that I could live for.
This next one is called This Little Light of Mine. I know you've heard it before. There's some new words to it, maybe for this version, so sing along. One, two. Here we go.
This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. Let it shine, let it shine, let it shine.
Here we go, one more time.
This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. Let it shine, let it shine, let it shine.
Jesus is the light.
Jesus is the light, I'm gonna let him shine. Jesus is the light, I'm gonna let him shine. Jesus is the light, I'm gonna let him shine. Let him shine, let him shine, let him shine. I'm gonna stomp my feet, and I will clap my hands and shout, shout. And I will run around, I'll jump up off the ground and shout.
Sing it again.
Well, I will stomp my feet, and I will clap my hands and shout, shout. Well, I will run around, I'll jump up off the ground and shout, shout. This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. Let it shine, let it shine, let it shine.
Let's sing that one more time.
This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. Let it shine, let it shine, let it shine. Oh, let it shine, let let it shine, let it shine.
Well, I'd like to share a Jesus story with you. This one is a story about a man named Lazarus. It starts out like this. Lazarus was sick, and Lazarus was a close friend of Jesus. In fact, he and his two sisters were very close friends of Jesus. He loved all three of them very much. Well, Lazarus's sisters' names were Mary and Martha. And actually, Mary is kind of famous. Mary is known for a time when she took a bottle of really expensive perfume. You know, perfume, like maybe what your mom wears to smell really nice. Well, she had a bottle of it, and it was really expensive. It was worth, like, years of allowance. She took it, and she poured it on Jesus' feet. And then she cleaned his feet off with her hair. She's famous for that amazing act of love toward Jesus. So that's who the story is about, Lazarus, Mary, and Martha. And it starts out like this. Mary and Martha, they sent word to Jesus to tell him that Lazarus, his close friend, is sick. Jesus said, basically to everyone around him, he said, don't worry, this sickness, it's not going to end in death. In fact, what's going to happen is going to bring a lot of glory to God and to the Son of God. Well, for some reason, Jesus didn't go right away to Lazarus. He said, we're going to stick around. And they stuck around for 2 whole days. It didn't seem very urgent to Jesus. And when the 2 days were over, Jesus said to his disciples, okay, guys, it's time for us to get up, and we're going to go see Lazarus in a place called Bethany in the area of Judea. Well, his disciples didn't like that idea. They were scared to go there to Judea. The reason why, there's a lot of people there that were angry with Jesus. So they said to Jesus, Jesus, I don't think we should go back into Judea. It's not safe. The people there, they actually want you dead. It's the last place we should go. Well, Jesus had a really interesting response for his disciples. So interesting. I want to read it for you. Here's what he said. Are there not 12 hours of daylight? Anyone who walks in daylight doesn't stumble because there's plenty of light from the sun. Walking at night, he might very well stumble because he can't see where he's going. That's pretty interesting, eh? I wonder what you think of that. I wonder what you think that means. Jesus often did that. He kind of spoke in riddles sometimes to get us to think about what does his words mean. Well, then he said this to his disciples, why they should go. He says, Lazarus, our friend, he's asleep, and we need to go and wake him up. Well, his disciples, they were even more confused, and they said to Jesus, Jesus, if he's asleep, taking a nap, and he's sick, that's a good thing, isn't it? We shouldn't go wake him up. We should let him sleep. It'll help him get better. Well, Jesus, he could see they weren't catching what he meant. So he had to level with them. He said, guys, I'm sorry to say this. I didn't mean he was taking a nap. I meant he has died. And I'm going to go and do something that's going to blow you away. It's going to give you a whole new reason to believe in me. Well, finally, one of his disciples spoke up with a lot of courage and said, okay, I know it's dangerous, but let's go. We're going to follow you there, Jesus. So they made the trip. And when Mary and Martha heard that Jesus was coming, they didn't wait for him to come into the town. They both, one Martha first, then Mary, ran to meet Jesus. And they both said this as a first thing to Jesus. They both said, Jesus, if only you had come sooner, maybe you could have saved our brother. You could have saved Lazarus. But Martha showed a little more hope in the situation. She says, but maybe there's something still that you can do. And Jesus said such a remarkable thing to them. Here's what he said. He said, I am the resurrection and life. The one who believes in me, even though he or she dies, will live. And everyone who lives believing in me does not ultimately die at all. And he asked Martha in particular, do you believe this? And she said, yes, yes, I do. I believe that you're the Son of God. That was important. That was a big clue about what might happen next. But the thing is, the people didn't know about that. And even Mary didn't know about that. So Mary started crying. And all the people around Jesus started crying. And Jesus, who was so moved by all the sadness around him, it says he started crying too. But he told them, okay, take me to Lazarus. Take me to where you've buried him. So next, they took him to Lazarus's tomb, which was actually kind of like a cave carved out the side of a hill with a big stone rolled in front of it. Jesus said, remove the stone. So with a bit of reluctance, they moved it. And then, you know what Jesus did? He called out to Lazarus. He said, Lazarus, come out. And you know what happened? He did. Jesus, just by speaking, raised Lazarus from the dead. And it says that he was still actually in his grave clothes. He just walked right out, looking kind of like a mummy. Jesus said to everybody, take off his grave clothes and then let him go. Well, that was it. That's the story of when Jesus raised Lazarus from the dead. And as you can imagine, that was a day his disciples and Mary and Martha and Lazarus and all those people, it was a day they would never forget. Great. I hope you enjoyed that story, that time together. Now we're going to move into an extended time of worship together.
I was buried beneath my shame, and who could carry that kind of weight? It was my soul till I met you. I was breathing but not alive, and all my failures I tried to hide. It was my tomb till I met you. You called my name day. You call my name.
give a quick shout of worship to God this morning. Dear Heavenly Father, God, we thank you so much for this moment that we can just enter into your presence. And God, as we do, I ask that you'd begin to speak to us right now, that you'd begin to open our hearts and minds to what you're speaking to us individually. God, that we'd be fully encapsulated by your Holy Spirit this morning. In your name I pray.
Jesus, come into this place, Father. I've carried a burden for too long on my own. I wasn't created to bear it alone. I hear your invitation to let it all go. I see it now, I'm written down, and I know that I need you. I run to the Father, I fall into grace. I'm done with the hiding, no reason to wait. My heart needs a surgeon, my soul needs a friend. So I run to the Father again and again and again and again. Oh, 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 again and again. You show my condition, had a plan from the start. For redemption, the price from my heart. And I don't have the context for that kind of love. I don't understand it, I can't comprehend. All I know is I need you. I run to the Father, fall into grace. I'm done with the hiding, no reason to wait. My heart needs a surgeon, my soul needs a friend. So I run to the Father again and again and again and again. Oh, 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 again. My soul found a friend, so I run to the Father again and again. My heart has been in your sight long before my first breath. Running into your arms is running to life from death. And I feel this rush in my chest, your mercy is calling out, and just
unto the Father, fall into grace. I'm done with the hiding, no reason to wait. My heart found a surgeon, my soul found a friend. So I run to the Father again and again and again and again. Oh, 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 again and again. This is the air I breathe. This is the air I breathe. In your holy presence, living in me. This is my daily. And this is my daily bread. Your very word spoken to me, and for you, and I'm lost without you, Jesus. This is the air I breathe. This is the air I breathe. Your holy presence living in me. This is my daily bread. This is my daily bread.
In this moment of worship, can we just reflect on all the things that we're grateful for, all the things that God's done for us in our lives? Just start to name those things in your head. Just start to worship Him for it.
Oh, I'm lost without you. I'm desperate for you. I'm desperate for you, God. Cause I'm lost without you. it for you. I'm lost without you.
God, we thank you so much, because we don't know where we'd be without you. God, you're the reason why we're here today. And God, as we reflect on those things, all the things in our lives that we're just so grateful for family, for community. God, there's so many blessings we can just lift up to you. God, we lift up our worship. You are the only one who's worthy. Let's just stay in this place of worship.
Cause Holy Spirit, you are welcome here. Come flood this place and fill the atmosphere. Your presence, God, is what our hearts long for. To be overcome by your presence, Lord. Holy Spirit, you are welcome. Come flood this place and fill the atmosphere. Your glory, God, is what our hearts long for. To be overcome by your presence, Lord. In your presence, Lord. In your presence, Lord. Your presence, Lord. Cause I'm desperate for you. And we're lost without you. We're so desperate for you. We're lost without you.
God, as we move into a time of hearing from your word, God, I ask that you'd be speaking to us. Continue to speak to us throughout the week. In your name I pray. Amen.
I hope you enjoyed that time of worship. I hope it was a blessing for you. In just a moment, we're going to celebrate communion. But before we do that, I thought we'd take a moment to reflect a bit on the story that we heard already today, that raising of Lazarus from the dead. That story is found in the part of the Gospel of John that's called the Book of Signs. It's called that because in that part of the book, Jesus performs a number of miracle signs. And it's important that we understand them as that, as signs, because they're not just acts of great power on Jesus' part, as if they're just for him to kind of show off or flex his spiritual muscles. No, they're meant to communicate really important things about Jesus. And the whole idea is that they might lead people who can see that in them to believe in Jesus and to believe in him kind of in regards to what they're communicating, that he's the Son of God, that he's the Messiah, that he's the resurrection, the life, that he's the Word of God. Some really important things that the Gospel of John is trying to get across to us. Now, this sign that we heard about today, it's this, the sign itself was by his word, Jesus raising Lazarus from the dead. So that's the miracle. That's the sign. I wonder what it's pointing to. What is it communicating? Let's take a moment to consider that. First, let's look at the circumstances around the sign. That's going to help us, I think, to better appreciate what it's pointing to. So the circumstances. First, notice who is involved. Lazarus is someone who John has taken a lot of time, well, I should say he's made the effort to show us that Lazarus isn't just a stranger to Jesus. No, this is someone who is close to Jesus, someone who has a special bond with Jesus. He's a close friend of Jesus. Even the way that it's introduced to Jesus, when Mary and Martha send word, they say, Jesus, the one that you love is sick. So that's an important detail. Another important detail is kind of the circumstances around his death. It's said that he was sick, and Jesus said, well, this sickness won't end in death. In other words, Lazarus is just like any other person. He's prone to sickness and death. So the death was one of natural causes. And lastly, we get this clue about the purpose of the miracle early on. And Jesus says that the whole purpose is that God would be glorified and that the Son of God would be glorified through it. So that's an important piece of this as well. Now for the sign itself. And a really big clue to its meaning is actually found in the conversation between Jesus and Martha. So let's read that. It's in verse 23 it starts. Jesus says to her, "Your brother will rise again." And Martha answered, "I know he will rise again in the resurrection at the last day." You see, many people believe that there was going to be this resurrection of the dead at the end of the age. So she's expressing belief in that. Well, then Jesus says to her, "I am the resurrection and the life. The one who believes in me will live, even though they die. And whoever lives by believing in me will never die. Do you believe this?" And she says, "Yes, Lord. I believe that you are the Messiah, the Son of God, who is to come into the world." That's a really beautiful conversation. It's been said that this is basically kind of one of the most significant expressions of faith by anyone in the Gospels. What's revealed here is so foundational, so important. And I think this captures it. This captures the meaning of the sign, what the sign is trying to communicate. It's communicating for everyone around what Jesus has stated clearly to Martha. Yes, people die. Lazarus, just like everyone else, he got sick and he died. But for those who believe in Jesus and have that special relationship with Jesus like Lazarus had, they will live even though they die, as Jesus said. And that's because, and here's what the sign is showing us about Jesus. That's because Jesus, as he says, he's the resurrection and the life. As the Son of God, he is the source of life itself. John 1 expresses this really powerfully. He's the Word of God, and through him, all things were made. Without him, nothing was made that has been made. In him was life. And that life was the light of all mankind. So, this sign speaks that powerful truth about Jesus. And like all the signs, there's an action step that people are invited into, that we're invited into as we read about this. For this one, if you see it, if you see that it's pointing to that about Jesus, you're invited to believe in Jesus. And in that way, you too will live even though you die. Now, you would think, for those who are watching this miracle, who saw it firsthand, you'd think, how could they not believe in Jesus upon seeing this? But that's the thing about signs. It's possible to misinterpret them. It's possible to misread them. In fact, the religious leaders have been majorly misreading Jesus' signs. Because of these, they think that he's working for the enemy. They think he's working for the devil. They think he's a blasphemer, so they want him dead. And even the people here in the crowd, some of them see it for what it is, and it says they believed in Jesus. But others, they believed more in the religious elite and the religious leaders. So they run off to tell them what had happened. So that's the important thing to note too about signs. But it's as many did believe. And I wonder what this is stirring in you as you read about it again, as we've heard the story again. What steps of belief is it inviting you to take? What's it revealing to you about who Jesus is? I invite you to consider those questions. Now I'd like to move into communion with all of this in mind. And here's the thing, there's a relation here, there's a parallel maybe going on between what we've talked about and communion itself. You've probably heard that part of the Christian world calls communion a sacrament. And a kind of a cool thing about that, that idea of a sacrament, it's really related to what we've been talking about. Sacraments are themselves signs. They are basically a physical thing or a bodily thing that points to something deeper, points to something spiritual, that are meant to communicate something deeply true about God, about Jesus. And the sacraments, like communion, have an action step. We take them or we participate in them believing in that reality. And in so doing, the Holy Spirit works in such a way as to bring us into a deeper relationship with Jesus, into deeper communion with Jesus. And not only that, but it's a bonding experience for all of us when we participate in it together. So this time of communion, in other words, it's a beautiful response to what we've just heard. It's a chance for us to express our belief in Jesus for what he's communicated to us about himself through these signs. Now, in Luke 22, that's where we're going to read now for our participating in communion. So let's read that together. It says, "When the hour came, Jesus and his apostles reclined at the table, and he said to them, 'I have eagerly desired to eat this Passover with you before I suffer. For I tell you, I will not eat it again until it finds fulfillment in the kingdom of God.' After taking the cup, he gave thanks and said, 'Take this and divide it among you. For I tell you, I will not drink again from the fruit of the vine until the kingdom of God comes.' And he took the bread, gave thanks, and broke it, and gave it to them, saying, 'This is my body, given for you. Do this in remembrance of me.'" So the bread itself, it's a sign. It's pointing to Jesus' body, reminding us of Jesus' body given on the cross for our liberation from sin and from evil. And so we take it, believing and remembering that. So let's take the bread together now and believing as we do. It goes on. "In the same way, after the supper, Jesus took the cup, saying, 'This cup is the new covenant in my blood, which is poured out for you.'" This cup points to the resurrection. It's a sign of the resurrection, the new life and the new covenant in Jesus' blood, the blood that was poured out for us on the cross. It points to this idea that his death and his resurrection, they mean new and eternal life for those who believe. So let's take the cup now, believing as we do. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for this opportunity to celebrate communion, keeping in mind all that this points to. The physical things, the bread and the cup, they point to really important things about you, Jesus. They point to your love for us. They point to the significance of the cross and of your resurrection. They point to you as the source of life, the source of resurrection life. They point to your great love for us in that you gave your body up on the cross so that we could have freedom, that we could have salvation, that we could be liberated from sin, from evil, and from death. And that story that we heard this morning of you raising Lazarus, I pray that it inspires us. It inspires us to remember that we too will be like Lazarus, that you give us that new life, that eternal life, that means that even though we die, we will live, that we will not ultimately end in death, but we will have life eternal with you. I pray for each of us that need to hear that in a special way today, that by your Spirit, that message would be really brought home into our hearts. It would be something that would give us hope and joy, and hope and joy that would carry with us through the week to the point where people would see us and ask, where is that hope coming from? Where is that joy coming from? So thank you, Jesus, for this time together. Thank you for this service that we've had now. It's in your name, Jesus, we pray. Amen. Amen. Well, great. I really hope that was a blessing for you. And I look forward to when we'll be back together like this next week. Just a quick reminder, it'll be available next Sunday later on in the afternoon. God bless. Bye. I was very-